So the Arctic oil rig came into Seattle at a time when we needed something to rally against. Between these four ladies, we represent the various parts of environmental activism. Zarna, at the end, over there, is a powerful force. As a writer, her voice comes out easily and cannot be ignored, especially at public hearings. Afrin is new to activism. She recently was with her tech job and to join the environmental activism when Shall Know came. So she bravely stepped in when she did not know anyone in the movement, but knew that it was something she needed to do. I want to talk more about that. So thank you, Afrin. And Sarra is a young, powerful voice. Oh, so. She's already challenging systems of oppression. And, you know, she works for the EPA and the city council member, Mike O'Brien. So she tackles the environmentalism from within and from the outside. So, thank you. And often with direct activism, activist work, they do not slow down. They do not sit and talk about their complexities of activism. So this is the first time we've gathered. This is the first time. And the first meeting that Zarna has set up for us, she actually canceled on us. And she didn't show. She went to Bellingham to help Kiara as she was being chained to the Arctic vessel. So this conversation is a rare occurrence. So I am grateful that they're willing to step into something so unfamiliar, especially when they haven't seen my questions. Their bravery to be vulnerable on stage. I invite the audience to listen for what is different, new, and surprising, with less judgment, so that we can connect in our heart and not in our heads.
Before we start the questions, we do want to say that we are beginning this event with respect to the Duwamish people, upon whose land we are standing, upon whose land we are sitting, upon whose land we are living, working, playing. We must acknowledge that this land was stolen from them, and that so much of what we do in the climate movement is not just about the science, it's about the people. It is about colonialism, it's about capitalism, it's about racism, it's about patriarchy, because these are the root causes of climate change, and these are the reasons why the Duwamish had their land stolen from them. Okay. Thank you very much. Go ahead, Yen.
Okay, so before we can really start on the questions that I have for them, I think there's some elephant in the room that we have to adjust to. Name. So why do we name this event Woman of Color?
I think it's really important to have a space for women and people of color in the environmental movement, because right now there, for the most part, really isn't, despite the fact that women and people of color are the most impacted by climate change. They're the most likely to be around a coal-fired power plant and the direct environmental hazards, but a lot of times their voices are silenced. They're told they're not experts, they aren't invited to the table. And so we thought if we could create a space where the voices of the most marginalized are able to speak, that it would be powerful.
Yeah. And also, I mean, following on from what Sarra was saying, is that, you know, in many ways, women of color feel as if there's no place for them here. You know, all they see is people who don't look like them. Yeah. And so it makes sense in building this movement. If we're going to build this movement, that means everyone has to be here, and particularly those who are most impacted, their voices are the most important. And so that is one of the reasons why we called this Women of Color Speak Out, because we have to speak out. because we have to invite our sisters in. We have to be here together.
Thank you. It's so, they're like applying. You guys are so cute. We can save the applause for later, guys. Or else we're never going to get through all of these questions.
No, I love the applause. Let them applause.
Snaps. Just work on the snaps. Work on that, guys. Or the fingers. But then the web people won't hear it.
Anyways, I like it.
Okay, so Sarra reminded me that it's my privilege to assume that you all know what climate change is. So, what is climate change?
You asking me?
You guys.
So, climate change is basically where humans have exploited the earth, have taken from the earth, have polluted the earth to such an extent that the climate of the earth is now being altered, that the climate is being warmed to a degree where it is making it very difficult for life itself to exist. Many species are going extinct. We are one of the species that is facing extinction. Scientists are calling it the sixth mass extinction. There's only been five in Earth's history. The last one killed the dinosaurs. And so when we talk about climate change, we are talking about climate justice. We are talking about our relationship to the Earth. We are talking about our relationship to each other. And we're talking about looking around ourselves and thinking about what is really important? What are our true priorities? Is money our priority or is life? Is food our priority or is the stock market? And we have to look at these different things and realize that we, each other, life, different species, the ocean, the sky, the land, the rivers, the lakes, all of these things are far more important than capitalism. And climate change has been caused by these very things. And so this is what climate change is, and this is why we have to talk about it.
And I think another thing with climate change is, I mean, sure, we can look at the science. We can see that we've put out more parts per million of CO2 than ever before. Recently, we hit that of 400, and we just hit a new record with 440 parts per million. And sure, there's all that science, and there's the fact that, you know, we've taken all of the hydrocarbons and the fossil fuels from which are supposed to be, which are the dinosaurs, and they're supposed to be underground, and we've brought them above ground, and we've now put them in the atmosphere, and now we're starting to see the impacts from that. But when we look at who did that, and when we look at, you know, who benefited from that? That's why when I see climate change, I see it as an extension of colonization, because none of this would have happened if everybody stayed in their own countries and didn't steal from each other and their resources. And when you look at who did it, it was the colonizers. It was primarily white countries. If you look at the historically who put out the most CO2, it's America, it's England, it's Germany, it's France. And the thing that they all have in common is that they're all majority white countries. They all have been colonizers, and when you look at who's most impacted, it's the opposite. It was the people who were colonized. It's the people who had those natural resources stolen out of their land. And so when we look at climate solutions, if we don't realize that this is an extension of colonization, unless we're changing our behavior toward people of color, toward those countries who are being most impacted, nothing will change. It'll be an extension. Even if we we go all renewable, we put in our carbon tax, and we all have electric cars. Well, all of those use precious metals, and most of those precious metals are, again, in the countries that were formerly colonized, and that includes exploitative mining, and it includes, you know, the same, if we go about climate solutions with that same capitalistic colonial framework, we're going to end up with another problem. Maybe it won't be climate change. Maybe we'll poke another hole in the ozone. Regardless, the way that we're going about this, and it's only been, humans have only been on this planet for a blink of the time, and an even shorter amount of time have we been burning fossil fuels. But yet, in that short amount of time, we've had these vast changes, and we have to slow down, essentially.
Thank you. So I was caught in a feedback group, in a feedback loop for 7 years.
Could you explain what you mean by a feedback loop?
Thank you. I think I was just caught in the mundane life, not knowing how to break free from it. And so the really sad example is I had finished my AA with 180 credits. And the only way that I was able to somehow break from that was from, and finding my purpose was being exposed to a community, new communities and new friends. And so, Afrin, how did you know that it was the right choice to step away and to really jump into this movement like 3 months ago?
I've worked at, you know, tech companies about 8 years. And I, you know, my first job straight out of college was at Google. And I remember finding myself at 24, 25, feeling really unhappy at what I was doing. And I had to stop and think about, oh, I have this job that supposedly is the, you know, it's the best company in the world to work for. And I still felt like I wasn't doing something meaningful. I really felt unhappy being there. And so I had to stop and ask myself, what is it that makes me happy? Is it having this job? But I felt like I wasn't working to a vision of my own. I was a puppet in somebody else's vision. And even though Google spoiled me and in a way could have seduced me to stay for many years, circumstances brought me to this country. So then that was a big shift when, you know, questioning the fact that I wasn't happy at that job. But that ended for me. And then coming here was, again, a shift, you know, exposing myself to a new country, a new culture. And I was enamored by this way of life that people back home couldn't have. The fact that I could own so many pairs of shoes and dream about having a big house with a yard and a car, make two cars or, you know, multiple cars per household was something that my family couldn't imagine. And I felt like it was my duty to acquire that lifestyle because so many people back home couldn't have it. You know, when I got divorced and some of those things were taken away from me, it once again was a moment of questioning, what is it that makes me happy? Once again, I found myself at a tech job, again feeling unhappy and knowing in my heart that this is not what I was meant to do. So this February, when they asked me to leave and I got laid off, a part of me for about 1 minute was ashamed and embarrassed and hurt. And then another huge part of me was like so happy and relieved and was saying that the universe is sending you towards something meaningful. And so I really felt determined to, you know, take time off this summer and find something meaningful to do. And I was like, what can I do? I know it's going to be something with the environment. You know, I can feel it. It's getting hotter. I don't like it. You know, reading about things back home. I was like, okay, I need to go plant some trees. Maybe that's what I need to do. But I showed up at multiple events, you know, and started hearing from people about Shell No, and I saw Zarna and Sarra speak at different spaces, and I kept showing up, and I kept asking people at tables, what can I do? I have all this free time, what can I do? And fortunately, I met multiple people from Rising Tide Seattle and started, you know, participating with them. At first, I really thought that just showing up at marches was important, and just my body, just the presence of one more body was important. But over the last few months, in being in conversations with these women and, you know, hearing from other folks and starting to get educated about racism and all of these other things that come into climate change, I felt like it's not enough just to bring my body. I also need to speak up. And I've been wondering where and how, and maybe it is writing a blog, but that's why I'm here. And, you know, I feel like the universe conspired to bring me into that space, to get me to meet people. And, you know, for Shell, for this whole Shell campaign to be happening in Seattle at this time, it was urgent, it was local. There was no way I could be sitting around at home watching this happen from my couch. So, many reasons.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you, Afrin. So I have a quote from my favorite system thinker, Margaret Wheatley. She says, those benefiting from the present system has no interest in your new ideas. In fact, your thinking is a threat to them. The moment you start thinking, you'll want to change something. And so my question is for you two. When did you start thinking, and how did you start your activist life?
Do you want to go first?
Okay. So I think part of it was just the way that I was raised for a long time, from like kindergarten till fifth grade. I was in a co-op type school. It was like a homeschool program, and just experienced a lot of free thinking, and you know, I wasn't taught about the, you know, barriers that I have both as a black person and as a woman. My parents tried in a lot of ways to like shelter me from that. And when I first started at, they thought it would be easier to transition in a private school, and it was a Christian school. And it was in fifth grade I found out it was a liberal, because just the way that people spoke about things, it was, they started to confine things. And they even, like, they said I had to wear a skirt on Thursdays, and I was like, no, I want to wear pants. Like, you can't tell me what to do. Like, this is my freedom. And and then in, like, fifth grade, I also got kicked out of my classroom because my teacher was telling us how it was God's plan to drill in the Arctic for oil. And I called her a liar and a polar bear killer, and she kicked me out. And she kicked me out of class, but I told my mom, I was like, Mom, I did the right thing. And she was lying. And she supported me, and I continued to get in trouble in class for speaking my mind. But my parents continued to support me. And then I got into like the more like radical activism, I guess. My mom's in the union, and so I've been to like labor protests, but I really kind of found my space in that during Occupy. And I just started college, and we got involved in like the student debt crisis. We started fighting for, you know, the right to go to school for free and a variety of things. But it also, I think, getting involved with activism during Occupy, it also gave me very much of an intersectional lens and able to see how these different movements are all connected. Because a lot of times some people want to be an activist for one thing, but it's the same systems of oppression that we're all fighting.
I was born in the 80s in England during the Thatcher government, and I remember being in school and hearing from my own family members that, you know, oh, the Thatcher government, they were the ones who stopped giving out free milk in schools, which of course meant that poor children who, for many of which, you know, that may have been the only nutrition they got all day, they stopped getting it. And I remember just being a child and thinking, this needs to stop. And, you know, I was brought up in a very political household. My family and the history of my family is very political. And so, you know, I grew up watching my father watch Newsnight on BBC Two. And being extremely bored by it. And then when I was like sometime around 14, 15, found out that I wasn't bored anymore. And I was listening and yelling at the TV. And when I, you know, and I went to a lot of protests. And when I became a college student, when I went to Cardiff University, I thought, yes, this is my chance, this is my time. I can get involved and I can be really active and, you know, and I can say stuff. And I did. And I got involved with People and Planet Society, which was very vocal in talking about the connection between the science and people. And I remember in, I believe it was 2000, during the Kyoto Protocol talks, the ones that the George W. Bush's delegates walked out of, I was standing outside with a group of people from all over the world. There were people there from Nigeria, there were people there from Nicaragua, which had just had these massive floods. There were people there from India, there were people there from Europe, and we were talking about how the Netherlands itself is a country that is already below sea level. And here we are in The Hague with the world superpower has walked out of these talks. And these are the talks that are supposedly going to create some kind of system that's going to get us out of this hole that we've dug ourselves in. And I realized when they walked out and the talks collapsed that we can't wait for politicians to fix this. They're not going to. They're not going to. They have had decades upon decades. It was 1988 when NASA actually said that climate change is real. 1988, and in 2000, America's delegates walk out of the Kyoto Protocol talks. So I was 18 at that time, and it became very clear to me that we need to be talking about sustainable housing, we need to be talking about food justice, we need to be talking about clean energy, we need to be talking about not going to colonized countries and stealing the resources that are there and in the process creating massive havoc and pain and destruction to so many people around the world. And so that kind of thinking has been in me for a long time. It just took a process. I remember being a child and writing articles about the tigers because they were going extinct, and they still are going extinct. And not articles that got published or anything, just for myself, you know, because we have to. If we are not educating ourselves, then it's very difficult to be a critical thinker and to watch the news and actually critically watch it, as opposed to just, oh, Fox News wants to tell us everything's okay. Fox News wants to tell us that climate change is some kind of propaganda. And so if we're going to be thinkers, we have to be critical thinkers, and not just of any opposite side, but also of ourselves. We have to be asking ourselves, what can I do? And what can my community do? And in many ways, that's one of the reasons why I wanted to do this event, is because I wanted to talk to my own community. I wanted to talk to Indian people. I wanted to talk to Hindu people, because particularly in Seattle, as you know, Afrin, you know, there are a great many people in my community who have, you know, positions of really great privilege and wealth, and they are educated, they have resources. We are people of hard work and dedication. We have come a long way, and there's no reason why we should not have a voice here. There's no reason why we should not be able to speak out, particularly when just a month ago, 2,300 people died in India because of a 122 degrees heat wave. And it's not people who are wealthy who are dying, it's people who have nowhere to hide from the heat, because there's nowhere to go that's air conditioned. When you're poor, there's nowhere that you can go to hide from that. And it wasn't many generations ago, one, that my own family was in that situation. And so I have to speak to my own demographic, because they know, they just do not feel as if they've been spoken to, and they feel as if there's no place for them. And so in thinking, coming along this route, I am now in this place, talking to all of you, and I hope that I'm also speaking to my own demographic.
I think what both of you mentioned is this connection to global, and to think more and beyond ourselves. And thank you. Because whatever happened to humanity, whatever is currently happening to humanity, it is happening to all of us. This is what Alice Walker had wrote in Overcoming Speechlessness. So what you're talking about, you know, this disconnection that we don't see this interwovenness between us and the downstream effects of what happens when things are thrown away or things are consumed. What are your thoughts on how do we reconnect us again?
To connect our different demographics?
Well,
or to
just
connect
to feel, just to, I don't know, feel interconnected in community and,
connected to community.
Yeah.
I think Afrin had something to say.
Yeah, I feel like for me personally, it was a long process of transformation, of questioning, you know, what makes, you know, just personal looking at myself. And then, you know, growing up in Bombay, it's this huge city of contradictions where there's billionaires and poor people living, you know, on the same street. And so that's where I grew up, seeing obscene wealth and obscene poverty, you know, and you kind of become numb to it. If that's where you grow up and that's what you see every day, it is your reality. And it's hard for your heart to bleed every time you see someone suffering. At some point, you can't afford to burst into tears every time you see someone. Mm-hmm. But for me, it was at moments of despair and at moments of hurt that I had to look into myself. And often the answer was through my practice of yoga, the answer was that, you know, it's only in seeing that we're all the same and we're, you know, connected that I could feel happy and I could find meaning in my life. And so that's what it was. It was many, many years for many bubbles to burst. Many bubbles of privilege, many bubbles of, you know, maybe what my parents put over me to protect me from hurt, that I had to burst on my own to come to realize that out of this conditioning of being selfish and out of this conditioning to just look for my own self-preservation, I was causing hurt to other people. And that those bubbles needed to burst, and that conditioning needed to be broken, and that selfishness needed to be dropped. So that was for me with fortunate or unfortunate series of questionings and hurt that those lessons came to me. But yeah.
Do you want to get this
one? So the question is, how have you stayed connected to your community, or?
Well, I think we're just so disconnected, I feel like.
Uh-huh. Yeah, definitely. I think we're disconnected from humans in a lot of ways. Social media, we have more friends than we ever had before, but we don't have any actual friends. Like, who can you call, like, when you want to cry on someone's shoulder or when you need someone to help you move? Like, who's actually there? And so that's... In a way, we're closer together, but further apart. You know, we bring a bunch of people together, and like a lot of people, especially from my generation and younger, like you'll have five people there texting, you know, next to each other. So in that way, I think we've disconnected. And it's crazy, like, I think this is part of Seattle's culture, the Seattle freeze of coldness, but I love talking to people on the bus, and I love talking to folks, and it's crazy because they're either a transplant or they're not like all the way there, or sometimes they have like nothing to lose, and the only people, you know, who talk to me are of those people, and it's just, it's sad. But I think the way I stay connected to my community specifically, I think part of it is this kind of dual identity, being that my mom is Black and my dad's Ethiopian, and as both like, you know, a second generation immigrant and as a Black person in America, those realities are a lot different. And I think sometimes I feel like, you know, the government in Ethiopia right now, it's really oppressive and they're not letting you speak out. And so I feel like I have to speak out about all of this injustice because I have that privilege as an American, but as a black person in America, some of that privilege is taken away. So it's interesting, but I think definitely having family abroad helps me look at these things from a global perspective, because in America, I mean, even here, we're in the middle of a drought, but when you turn on your faucet, water comes out. So, you know, we're not noticing that drought, but the people who are most impacted do. And by keeping like a global perspective and remembering that I have family still in Ethiopia that are having to deal with these issues on a lot more real basis than I am, I think it makes me feel like I have to be accountable to them. Even though some of them I haven't met before, I still feel like I have to remain accountable and you know, work on taking down these systems and stopping things like pipelines and the TPP, because all of this is going to affect my family back there the most.
And one thing that absolutely, I think that both of you are absolutely right, is that, you know, having that global perspective and it being a spiritual journey, like particularly for me, I feel like it is a spiritual, like to have a spiritual awareness, to realize that you are not different from me. We come from the same earth. We come from the same ground. Our bodies are made of the same thing. And one thing that I try to remember, and I think that it's important to talk to each other about, is the fact that you and I, or anyone else, feeling disconnected from each other is a symptom of the system. It is a symptom of a colonial system, a racist system, a patriarchal system, a capitalist system, a system that wants you to think about your shopping and doesn't want you to think about your community. You know, we used to grow food locally. We used to grow food locally and then eat it locally, eat it communally, come together as a society. People used to come together around the campfire or the hearth and actually tell stories, actually talk to each other, look at each other, play music, dance. These are all ways in which we can still do that. But instead, no. You have to go to a club. You have to pay to get in. You have to wear the right clothes. You have to listen to the music only other people want you to listen to, because that's what's cool, that's what's in, that's what's fashionable, that's the system. And I think that if we are going to be connected to each other, if we're going to reconnect, we have to start stepping back from those things, and we have to start saying, what is happening in my community right now? Who is hungry right now? Who is suffering right now? Who doesn't have a home right now? We have a massive homeless community here in Seattle, and that is not something that is separate from the rest of the world. There is a massive homelessness crisis in this country, and that is not separate from other countries. That is simply a knock-on effect. It is a domino effect. We have been displacing and making people homeless in other countries for decades and centuries. And in this country also, we started this by talking about stolen Duwamish land. Where do you think they went? What do you think happened to them? When the people who colonized this area burned down the Duwamish longhouses, what do you think happened to those people then? These things are not disconnected from each other. These are not coincidences that we burned down Duwamish longhouses 150 years ago, and today you have white veterans being evicted from their homes by the sheriff's department because Chase Bank wants their home. It's not a separate occurrence. It is simply, first they came for the black people, and I did not listen because I was not black, and so on and so forth.
Vote for Zarna. She doesn't want to campaign a political career, but we'll push her that way. Anyways. I do want to talk about race, given that it's a woman of color event. I've been to two Shall Know Action Council meeting, and you know, they're our sponsor. I adore them. And they facilitate, you know, Chi activists and a lot of the movements. You know, the word tokenism kept getting brought up. Can you explain what tokenism is? And how do we address it?
I would start by saying, like, tokenism is really, like, not actually inviting, like, the entire community, but inviting one person to speak for their entire community. And that happens a lot in the environmental community. I've played a good part in that, being the black token. You know, at first I didn't realize it for a long time. I remember I just thought, you know, everyone loved me, and that's why I was always, like, in the front, and they'd always put me in their pictures. And I'd be like, well, you didn't ask to use my picture. Like, why am I on your front page? I don't even work with you. And so it just started, and I didn't understand it at first, but then when I realized what they were doing was trying to paint this picture of non-racist, because they didn't actually go out and do the work and try to, you know, work in those communities and do the outreach that's needed. Instead, they tried to, put, you know, a person of color's face in the front, and show, like, oh, look, we're not racist, or try to make it look like they're diverse. And I mean, it happens everywhere, and it's a catch-22 because, like, if your pamphlets don't have people of color, you know, it might be the case that it will continue to be there, because who are you advertising to? But at the same time, I think that the outreach work needs to be done, instead of just trying to tokenize, because it really it's lazy. It's not doing. It's showing that there, you know, that your community isn't worth the effort, but we just want to look like we're not this way, and so it's offensive.
And it's also, you know, like there are certainly, I think, definitely, you know, elements of that have been throughout the climate movement in the West, in certain ways. And I think there is also, just to be fair to everyone, it's also a matter of capacity. You know, when you have, you know, people who are working so hard so long with very few resources, and they're trying to do the work, like five people trying to do the work of 100 people, you know, and the same people. And because that outreach hasn't been done, more people aren't coming in, but it also means that that outreach can't be done because more people aren't coming in to do it. And so one of the things that I feel called to do as someone who is in this movement and someone who is a person of color, someone who is in this particular demographic, is to do that outreach. You know, I know that in many ways, you know, yeah, I have been a token. And at the same time, for me personally, it has been intentional. Because I want to speak to my community. I want to be able to say, my brothers and sisters and everyone in between, please join this movement. We need you all here because every single voice is important. And in terms of, you know, being on the Shell No Action Council, wouldn't it be absolutely fantastic if we had a Desi affinity group? Wouldn't it be absolutely fantastic if we had an Ethiopian group? Wouldn't it be brilliant if we had a Taiwanese group, a Vietnamese group, or you know, all of the other denominations within those groups? Because there are many, many different groups and tribes and faith backgrounds within those that need to be spoken to, because they all have concerns. And they're all concerned about this in different ways. And so the tokenism is there, but at the same time, we all have to come together and think about creative ways, new ways, so that we can do that outreach and also not be pointing fingers and not blaming people to the extent that they feel as if nothing they do is working. Because that's not fair either, I don't think. You know, there's so much work to be done, and that is why I invite everyone to be part of this. There is so much work to be done, really.
Thank you. You know, we talked about Kai activism, or I did. Can I name an elephant? Why do we fight oil with plastic kayaks? And why do we drive cars to rallies?
Yeah, I mean, why would you want to drive your car and bay on your plastic kayak that's all made of petrochemicals?
I think that excuse, which I heard coming from, like, everyone from the Heritage Foundation to Fox News, it really, we're trying to change the system here,
And there's a reason, because at this current system, it's a fossil fuel-based economy, and that they've trapped us in this system where you cannot live a day without fossil fuel unless, you know, you go out of your way to go out in the woods. And, but then you aren't changing the system. Mm-hmm. Then you're just hiding in the woods. So it's gonna take, you know, yes, we'll have to use, like, the master's tool to take down their house, but at the same time, it's important we realize, like, if driving there instead of taking the 3-hour bus is gonna allow you to do more work and to get, you know, closer to the goal of where you won't have to use it, closer to the goal of a fossil fuel free future, then it's worth it, because that is a bigger impact than hiding in the woods. And it's also important, what I've heard a lot of people talk about was during slavery, well, the abolitionists, a lot of times their clothes was made of cotton picked by slaves. And it wouldn't make sense for them to fight naked. No one would talk to them. You know, they had to use those tools, but at the same time, you know, they continued to fight it regardless of, you know, whether or not their clothes was made, you know, slave free.
And you know, absolutely. Thank you. And one thing that has to be said is, you know, comments like that, but you're in your plastic kayak, that is divide and conquer.
Yes.
Okay, that is a way by which the other side, and by other side, I mean the CEOs who have benefited from this destructive capitalist system, that is their way of making us fight amongst ourselves. That is their way of distracting us from the actual issue, which is a white European company called Shell wants to go to the Arctic where brown people live and wants to extract things from the earth there, which is going to destroy their ecosystem and the ecosystem of the entire world. And instead of making you, like, letting you think about that, no, plastic, distraction, okay? That's like their number one misdirect. And so whenever you hear that, understand and call it out that what you are saying right there is propaganda from the fossil fuel company. When you say that, you are basically their mouthpiece. So congratulations for being their mouthpiece, but you are not helping anyone, you are hurting us.
Thank you, Zarna.
To me, I just feel like I've read that just these corporations have spent so much money depriving science from developing that is going to allow renewable clean energy to come into the market. So patents and, you know, new design solar panels that could have made, you know, energy easier for us to have are being, you know, stopped and, like, repressed. And so that's all part of this huge system that is, you know, stopping us from stepping off the fossil fuel train, and it's terrifying. It's massive. But each of us becoming aware of it, I think, is a step. Talking about it is a step, and doing our little bits, I think, makes that difference too. So,
yeah. And getting out in the streets makes a difference. Let me give you one example of how the system totally just enslaves you to the fossil fuel system. So right now, we have this financial collapse, which was caused by the banks. People got displaced. They got thrown out of their homes. Now they can't afford anything and their credit is shot, which means they have to move further out in order to find somewhere to live where they can, which is a place that they can actually afford. But then they also cut the public transport system. So instead of being able to get a bus into work, now you have to buy a car, even though you can't afford it, and even though you don't want to use that fuel. But no, now you're roped into not only paying massively high rent, but you're roped into buying a car, making car payments, paying into the fossil fuel industry, and it never ending. And it goes on and on and on. So we have to speak up about climate justice. We have to speak up about transit justice. This is not an accident that they cut public transport. It's not an accident while giving corporations massive subsidies. That's not an accident either. We've had so many conversations internally about this that it's just like we're all giving each other secret looks. Like, yeah, she made that point.
Like when we have our, when we're together for 3 hours and then it's like 11 p.m. We're like, well, maybe we should talk about work. So Thomas Edison said, what you are will show up in what you do. And I feel like, Sarra, like that has shown up in a lot of your work. How does activism intersect with various things that you're involved with?
I would say, like, in a lot of ways, I'm forgetting her name, but the quote that says, being a black person in a black woman in America, you know, just to survivor's resistance. So in a lot of ways, I see, like, you know, my position in city council, and you know, the work that I do, I see it all as a kind of a form of resistance. But then also, like, there's a lot of things that I come involved with, and even as I was younger, there's things I didn't understand that I got involved with, and I didn't understand how I was falling to this system that was built to trap me. And you know, and I did get trapped in some ways, and I did fall into those. For example, one of which, at my school, when I first started public school, I wasn't really aware of a lot of the stereotypes attached to my kind. And so I was at a really white school, and the basketball coach was like, you're just what we need for our team. And I didn't understand why I'd never played in my life. And so I was like, yeah, I'll play. Like, he's so happy about me playing. I don't know why. I traveled and I put the hoop in the wrong place and all of that. And I pissed him off. But then on top of that, like the way they, the students there, they kept asking me to rap for them, and I didn't understand why either. And I did poetry, and I was really good at poetry, and poetry's pretty much rap. And so I did rap because, like, I got a lot of attention for it in seventh grade. That's pretty important. And so, you know, I did all these things, falling into these traps and not realizing it. I begin to see it, but it wasn't until, like, years later when I looked back and saw, like, for example, I got suspended for having a rap battle, but the white boy who invited me to do it didn't get suspended. And they said, oh, well, they didn't know about that before you came. And then later on, after they realized I wasn't going to be their basketball star, they expelled me for bringing supplements for, like, they were mixed of, like, their stomach supplements. They had, like, ginger and cinnamon. And they said it was a drug, and expelled me from the school. And it was my first year of public school. And, like, and I didn't know about the prison-to-school pipeline. Like, I didn't realize that they expel black students at a higher rate, and that they criminalize us from the day that we walk in, starting from kindergarten, and that because I was out of that system and I had been sheltered from that. But it wasn't and it wasn't even while it was happening, I didn't realize that this was part of a larger system. But, you know, years later, now that I see that, it inspires me more to fight it, because I know myself I got trapped into it, you know, despite having, you know, coming from a good family and having support, and it still happened. So I can only imagine all the other kids who aren't fortunate enough to have two parents, or aren't fortunate enough to have, you know, parents who will come to bat for when they get thrown in the, you know, suspension for no reason.
Do you want to go, Afrin, or should I go? I grew up in an Indian Hindu family, and within the philosophy that I was taught, there is this law, it's called the law of karma. You might know it as karma. It's pronounced karma. And very precise. And the law of karma is that for every action, there is a reaction. And so I was brought up with this understanding that everything that you do has an effect not just now, but in the future. And so what you do must be something good. Because if you hurt people, then that hurt will not only increase, but it will come back to you. And so it was this sense of being more conscious of the people around me. Like, I remember being in college and making sure that my music wasn't too loud because I didn't want to disturb the people in the rooms around me, which is, of course, crazy because everyone knows college is a time and place for really loud music. But no, I mean, it was something that was very instilled in me from a very young age. And so, you know, to be an activist now, it's not a huge step, it's not a huge leap. You know, to know that everything that I do has a direct impact on this earth. For example, I was raised vegetarian. And, you know, being Hindu, I grew up hearing many different spiritual leaders talk about vegetarianism and about nonviolence and about not exploiting other beings. And one spiritual teacher, Sri Ramesh Oza, who I consider to be one of my gurus, Sri Ramesh Oza said something, and I heard it when I was a child, and it had a very deep impact on me. He said, never turn your body into a graveyard. Mm. Never turn your body into a graveyard. And it had a very deep impact on me because I really thought about the violence of the meat industry and the violence of the food industry and the agricultural industry and how when you look at climate science today, we have found that 51% or more of all global greenhouse gas emissions come from the meat and fish industry. That's more than cars, that's more than plastic kayaks, that's more than the lights in your house, it's the food on your plate. That is something so fundamental. And so, as someone who has been raised vegetarian, I'm infinitely grateful for that. But it's also something that I feel like I have to talk about, not as a Hindu proselytizing, because in fact, that's not what a Hindu does. But as an activist, I feel learning these statistics, learning the science, understanding how amazingly destructive it is to this planet that we live on, I have to speak. Because karma, for every action, there is a reaction. And the food on your plate has a reaction around the world. And there are people who do not have food on their plate because of the food on your plate. And this is something that we have to recognize. And me personally, as someone who has been raised this way, it's something that I have to be constantly conscious of. But I feel like, in many ways, I feel like I'm failing that part of myself because I haven't spoken about it enough, because I'm Hindu and I don't want to proselytize. And but as an activist, I've come to this realization where this isn't about my religion, this isn't about my faith, this is about the facts, and the facts are undeniable. And so I feel like there are so many ways in which it connects, but for me, that's one of the ways that's so fundamental.
Well. So I just want to say, like Zarna is like the extreme version of me. Like she's I am the quiet, passive Asian, and she's like the loud, proud, and you know she's like vegan, and I'm not. And so like I said, like we represent the spectrum of environmentalism. Like it's not you build up to that point maybe. I don't know, but you know you have to kind of start somewhere. And I know.
Did you just say one day you might be Zarna?
That's a really high bar. I think, like, for me, like, it took me a few years to even get the habit of, like, carrying my own bags. And, you know, for me to even, like, wear thrift, like, this thing was $8. Like, you know, that concept, like, really working with that tension took a while. And it's, you know, the habit is hard. And so I have another quote, because I love quotes. We are what we repeatedly do, so excellence then is not an act, but a habit. and that's from Aristotle. And I think, you know, we have to start somewhere, and I think the points of what we're trying to say is actually just starting. Not so much like the vegan. But you guys kept talking about the science. And the science is so hard to process. It's so hard. Like, when I, you know, hear about it, I just want to, like, crawl into a shell and not even face the world anymore. Like, why? And, you know, having that emotional capacity to process science, I think that is something that environmentalists needs to work on, that the movement itself. Because I can't barely comprehend, you know, my rent and my student loans and, you know, life and the complexity of life. And how am I supposed to, on top of all of that, handle the science that's being thrown at me in Facebook and Twitter and every single media that I see? And so I think that's my question is, how do you digest the science?
So for me, because the science is still so new and I'm still just chewing on it, and my circle of friends and peers really are people who, you know, are still living in the bubble that I was in 3 or 4 months ago, where, you know, they acknowledge that, oh yeah, it is a problem, but still haven't made that move of stepping and doing something about it. And so recognizing, seeing that even, you know, in the people I live with and the people I worked with, just for me, it really was to try and be, to live up to what I was trying to do and be an example and be an inspiration. I remember when I first started doing yoga and turned spiritual, and it was a sudden turn. I was at 21, a girl who liked to party and drink, and then I had a moment of heartbreak, and then I was all of a sudden not drinking. You know, it was a quick transformation, and my friends, they didn't believe that it was gonna last. They just thought that it was just a phase. But at that, I was so impassioned about this change in me, and I really wanted everyone to see the world the way I did. And I spoke about it so passionately, like trying to convert people to do yoga and become spiritual, and quickly learned that that's not the way you do it. You don't do it by talking about it and, you know, trying to forcefully change perspectives. But it really was, I realized, staying true to myself, staying true to that being my choice of transformation and, you know, my direction. And then people around me noticed. People around me saw the change and were more willing to ask questions and be curious about why I chose certain things and why I lived a certain way. And so the same thing, I think, if the science is hard to talk about, and I honestly, when my roommates ask me about why I'm doing certain things, I'm not able to always counter their arguments about the economics of things, but I know in my heart that the direction in which our world is going is wrong, and I know in my heart that we have to change. We're coming to a tipping point. And to me, that is sufficient. That is enough reason to change how we're living. So when the conversation becomes too technical, I speak from my heart and, you know, give examples about things that mean to me that might not exist, like beaches. You know, if the ocean level rises, we're going to lose our beaches because, you know, beaches take thousands and thousands of years to get formed. And, you know, so just talking about things that people can relate to makes it easier for them to see the perspective. And I think just being an example is the way I try and do it.
I came from when I started at the University of Washington, I really thought I was going to solve climate change through science. And, you know, and I got involved in so many labs, and I was so excited and bright-eyed. And you know, I started realizing that I wasn't going to solve anything when they said, they started saying, well, you know, there comes a point, you know, if you're going to go to grad school, you're going to have to choose between, you know, whether or not you do activism or science. And I thought that was a little off point, you know.
off because I had done a lot more through activism than through science. But what kind of showed me that it was activism and that was the path that I had to go through, I was working at NOAA and we're working on some ocean acidification research, and we're able to see these tiny shells, pteropods, which make up the bottom of the food chain, dissolving in the current state of the ocean. And I was so shocked that I could see with my own eyes through the scanning electron microscope that these animals were dying, like right now, not in the future, today. And I was like, well, we're the federal government. Like, let's do something. Like, this is all the evidence we need. The bottom of the food chain is crumbling. The rest of the ocean is going to die. Like, what more do we need? And she's like, no, we're gonna write another report and hope that someone reads it. We're gonna put out some policy recommendations. And I was like, it's not working. And that's when I got involved in like fossil fuel divestment and started working more on that angle, because I realized like, yeah, it's important that we know how bad the problem is, but science isn't going to solve the problem. Science is only gonna tell us how bad it is. And we've already seen with the climate scientists, for the most part, they've been really disengaged. So we can't look to them for our saviors. We have to be our own saviors. And that's really what activism has given us.
And one thing that I would like to add to that is that, you know, I think that humans have this amazing capacity for hope. And we have this beautiful capacity for compassion. And we have this, and often when we decide to do something good, they marry. And for example, my family is from India. My grandfather was 15 years old when he shared a jail cell with Gandhi. He was just a child. And the British Empire that was feeding itself on India's blood and the blood of many African countries, the blood of many countries in the Middle East, in the Far East, the British Empire was created by a capitalist system. It was actually the East India Company, which was a corporation that first came to India and began to sink its hooks of control and domination. It was a system of racism that fed in to that system of capitalism. It was that system of oppression that basically led to a country in a freezing island off the coast of Europe, deciding that they had a right to control this massive country of millions of people on the other side of the world. And when we look at climate change, when we look at the fossil fuel industry, when we look at fossil fuel extraction, the fact that Shell, for example, is a European country and wants to go up to the Arctic, the fact that it was Shell that went to Nigeria and absolutely ravaged the Niger Delta, the fact that it was a white European country, Shell, that went to Peru and did what they did to the people there. This is something that we around the globe, that these different people in these different countries can relate to each other on. When I see what's happening in the Arctic, I see my grandfather. I see my people. I see the people in Nigeria. I see the indigenous people here. And that connection is something that we all have to see. It's something that we all have to recognize. And we're not going to recognize it until we talk about it, until we make those connections, until we say, oh, you know, there was a massive drought in Ethiopia where Sarra's family came from. And it was because of that drought that so many people in Ethiopia had to leave their country. And that drought wasn't by accident. It didn't just happen. These things are connected to our fossil fuel usage that is happening, the majority of which has happened in history, in Western white colonial countries. And so when I look at how we connect with each other and how we look at it beyond the science, I look at the people, I look at the cultures, I look at the history, and I look at these conversations that we can have as families, as friends and look at each other's cultures and see how in history we have resisted. We resisted the British Empire and we kicked them out. We can do it again.
It's already been an hour.
Really?
Yeah. So now we're going to shift and we're going to invite questions from the audience and we're going to take a break. So one of the questions is, I had to do a handwritten one because I had to include the grannies in this conversation. I love them. They're the best. Thank you, grannies. The climate movement is very white. Is there any way we, white people, are discouraging people of color from joining? And there's two other issues that were asked about white. White people do outreach work in the community, and we submitted invitations, but no luck, no responses. So those are the questions about whiteness. What are your thoughts on those?
Obviously, engaging in race in America is a difficult topic. That being said, when I first started getting involved in the environmental movement, I thought that there was a certain amount of racism I would just have to take in order to work in this movement for a long time. A lot of it was just microaggressions. So you speak so articulate. That's offensive. because a lot of it was a lot of people who were trying to compliment me with these things that you're like, English is my only language. Of course I speak English well. Like, and so there was a lot of those questions prodding, not knowing that you're being offensive, but you are being offensive, or having to explain, or having white people being like, how can we get more black people? What's wrong with them? Why aren't they joining us? And I'm like, it's these questions right here. Having to speak for my entire community as if I was a spokesperson, all of that is just, it doesn't help. And then also, like, when communities of color stand up and say something, and then when they get challenged by predominantly white folks, and told that, you know, they're not the experts, and that's also offensive. But I also think, like, even, like, there's certain things that maybe it's not purposely, but it is condescending, and it just makes it very toxic environment to work in and not inviting. But I think, I imagine it would be hard as a white person working, trying to outreach in these communities. But I think it starts with, friendship, getting to know them as individuals, getting to know their struggles, inviting them to coffee, making friends. And from there, asking them to join in this work and understanding, especially when you're talking about activism, especially when you're talking about black people, you're asking them to do a lot more when you're asking them to go out on the streets and be confronted by police. You know, it's not the same risk that we go in to when we're, doing this work together and doing the same things together. So having that understanding is going to help so that you don't ask them to do these things that are really sometimes can be uncomfortable. But I think really it starts with friendships, and it's hard because even in Seattle, we have segregated public schools, we have segregated neighborhoods, so, segregated friendship circles. So, if all of your friends are white, and we have about 30 to 40% of people of color, there's obviously that wasn't by chance, but it's not necessarily your fault because, like I said, we're in a lot of ways, a lot of our activities, our communities are still segregated. One of the most segregated hours every week is during 11 o'clock on Sunday, church. So we still have these patterns of wanting to be around each other, around people that look like us. But when we want to engage and do these cross-racial work, it starts with friendships. before you can ask them to come out and do these things for you, come out to these meetings, starts with friendships.
But I have to cut you off because we have like four other questions, but maybe it will intertwine with this. So how does your identity as a woman sophisticatedly inform or influence your role as an environmental activist?
As a woman, how does that inform? Well, for me, there are so many different ways. For example, you know, I myself do not have children, but I helped my sister raise her children. I know that when you have a life that you have created of your own body, that changes something inside you. And fatherhood is powerful as well. I've spoken to many, many, many people who talk about that as well. But we all know, and particularly within my culture, within, you know, Indian culture, it always talks about how your mother is your first guru. Your mother is your first teacher. And so there's this idea of women and a woman's voice and a woman's wisdom, a woman's compassion, a woman's ability to reach out with love that is so necessary in this movement. A lot of the voices have been very clinical. They've been very scientific. They've been very robotic almost. Oh, well, parts per million and this data and that data. But there's been no human touch. There's been no maternal touch. There's been no sisterhood. And that is so necessary because, by the way, we're 50% of the population. And I think that also, coming from my own particular background where I see the earth as my mother. And so when I stand up and do something to defend her, I'm defending her as a child. I'm defending her as a child of earth. And that means that everyone here is my brother and sister. And so that that sense of worshiping the divine feminine and connecting with that and being aware of that power and that love and that compassion and also that destructive ability. And when I talk about destructive ability, I'm not talking about violence because that's not how we're going to solve this. I'm talking about dismantling this destructive system. That's what I'm talking about. We have to harness that power that women have where we will speak out, we will speak the truth, and through our voices, we're not gonna allow this patriarchal system where we're gonna go in and drill into the earth and take what we want, whether the earth wants it or not. We need to stop that. That is a patriarchal system, and that is a system that is hurting us. Clearly we see it is hurting us.
Yes, I feel like you should add on to this, especially mm-hmm. since we're a woman of color panel.
Yeah, for me, it's been just my own journey of empowerment as a woman. I've felt awkward and shy my whole life, and maybe that has something to do with growing up in a culture where women are just sexually objectified constantly. It wasn't until I moved here that I felt that I noticed how bad it is, and that I realized that every time I stepped out of my house back home, I was layering on walls and walls to protect myself from being groped or harassed or just constantly verbally accosted by men. So coming here was, changed a perspective. And then since then, it's been thinking about what it means to be a woman, and a lot of things that Zarna says resonate with me because it's the same culture, the culture of recognizing the divine feminine. And I've been reading a lot about that personally, thinking about self-empowerment, thinking about creativity, thinking about playfulness and expression in ways that are not logical and intellectual, but come from a different space of heart and love and play. So And that has kind of been what I've tried to bring into my world, as into my work as an activist too, is remembering to have fun, remembering while we're working on really serious and grave issues, remembering to, yeah, to stay grounded and, you know, share that love with other fellows, you know, feeling that sisterhood and brotherhood. So, you know, wearing a dress and skirt to me was something that I never did back home. I never wanted to feel feminine because it was something I didn't want to wear. But here I have the last few years really embraced that, and I'm still in the process of growing into myself, and it's fun and I'm enjoying it. I'm going to be 30 in less than a month, and I think I'm excited for that new chapter to open up for me. Yeah.
I guess the last thing I would add to it is the data. There's some research that Sightline did that showed in Washington State that the base of the climate voters and the people who are worried about climate change is women, you know? And when you think about that and really try to take that apart and find out why, I mean, you know, they make some generalizing statements, and I don't like gender, you know, binding and all of that, but I'm just gonna do it. You know, women bring a lot of empathy, and they bring, you know, like a lot of emotion, and they bring a lot of feeling. And what climate change, you know, and all that data and science, the people who are doing a lot of this work is a lot of people who are feeling the impact, who are feeling the, you know, catastrophe that will be brought on if we don't change our behavior. And I think that's a type of power that can be elevated and can be brought in, because I think that's what the climate movement is missing.
Thank you. I think we have one last quick question, is what causes and organizations are you working with?
Sorry?
Causes and organizations are you involved with?
Okay. So I am in Rising Tide Seattle, which is a direct action group that confronts the root causes of climate change. I am involved with Earthship Seattle, which is about radically sustainable housing. And it's about finding, there are six principles that go into that. One of them is clean energy. One of them is recycling and using natural materials to build, growing food, catching rainwater, treating your own sewage, and building and constructing in a way where we're using less energy because the building heats and cools itself. You know, ways like this, things like this are so important to talk about because rather than just talking about dismantling the system, we also have to talk about building the future. And so I'm part of Earthship Seattle. I am part of this collective right here that has just popped up. I've been part of Backbone campaigns work with the Kai activist movement, People and Planet. I'm not in them now, but I was in the past. I could go on, but I'll stop.
I am with Rising Tide Seattle and this little collective too here that's growing. But I also feel like for me, the first few times when I stepped out and I was going by myself, and you know, didn't know who I was going to be marching with, and it was awkward the first couple of times. But I think as I, you know, made eye contact and made little conversation and saw the same faces over and over again, I feel like every time I go out, and whether it is with Rising Tide or not, I feel like I feel safe when I'm out. I feel loved. I feel like there's solidarity wherever I go, whatever march. And so, yeah, while I may be with Rising Tide, when the main work that I do, I feel like I want to participate in as many causes as I have time for.
So I am involved with Got Green. It's a really awesome organization that's community colors led, and they work in like South Seattle, working on environmental and climate change justice. And I've also been active in the Black Lives Matter movement. I've also been working on the fossil fuel divestment campaign at UW. We got them to divest from coal. We're still working on fossil fuel.
I'm also working on getting the Greek system to be reformed and taking out a lot of that patriarchy and racism and classism. I'm also working on just started like juvenile prison abolitionism in this city and hopefully beyond. Yeah, and that's a few.
How about you, Yen?
Don't have time for that. So I realized we skipped our sponsors. So do you want to speak for snack and Backbone real quick, because we're already over time?
Yeah, sure. So our two lead sponsors who made this possible was the Shell Note Action Council and Backbone. The Shell Note Action Council was created very, very recently when it came to light that the Port of Seattle had made this secret deal with Shell through Foss Maritime, that is a local company. When it became public that this is what the Port of Seattle had done, and that they were basically allowing Shell to bring their Arctic drilling rig and their fleet into our waters and to make Seattle party to Arctic drilling, which is a crime against the planet. There were many, many people within Seattle who immediately rose up, many different groups, one of them being Backbone, another being Rising Tide Seattle, another being Greenpeace also came to Seattle, the Raging Grannies, People and Planet. There were so many different groups who were saying, we have to do something. And so we came together and we created a very horizontal structure where no one was in charge of anyone else. We were all able to make our own decisions about what we wanted to be part of, but we were all helping each other and supporting each other. And there are hiccups, as there always are, but Shell Note Action Council, because of the work that we have done, Shell Note Action Councils are now popping up all over the West Coast, and indeed around the world. There were 30 protests against Shell in Germany. There have been protests in Denmark. They are training kayaktivists in Denmark. There have been actions in London. There are actions happening around the world. So that is the Shell Note Action Council. Backbone. The Backbone campaign is this amazing space where what they do is they create a space whereby other groups and other people can find their voice. And they talk about many different issues, whether it's climate justice, whether it's social justice, whether it's housing justice. When I first moved to Seattle 2 years ago, I actually came into contact with Backbone through housing justice, which is what I was working on at the time. And so what Backbone Campaign does is it is in many ways a backbone. It's there to kind of provide a space, and they are actually having an action camp this August, so just in a couple of weeks. It's August 11th to August 17th on Vashon Island. We are going to be there for one evening where we are going to be doing a panel. I'm going to be there the whole week. And so we would really, you know, love to see you all there. You can go on Backbone's website, and you can also speak to people here about booking people. If you can't make that camp, you can also sponsor other people to go, because that's what a lot of what Backbone does is, if you don't have money, we will find someone who does and put things together so that more people can act. And so those are two lead sponsors. We really want to thank them.
And the Shell Note Action Council, they're having another meeting, I believe it's August 6th, August 10th.
Yeah. Double check with Rising Tide over
yeah.
there.
So it's the 10th. Okay. August 10th at 6:30, and it's going to be at
The Hillman Collaboratory.
So it's not dead, it's not over. Shell's still coming back, and there's still more work to do, and we'd like to invite you all, and you and your friends.
Okay, so as you know, on behalf of the Cascadia Climate Collaborative, we're really grateful that you step into this unknown and, you know, explore this with us, and, you know, the whole audience came and was present here for it. So we have gift baskets for you with sponsors from Yes Magazine, some chocolates, and Central Co-op. There's So they helped, and so just as a thank you. We do, I'm going to leave you with a quote, and then I will invite you to enjoy some food and some, how do you say it?
Jai.
Jai. It's not chai, it's jai.
No, chai.
Chai.
It is chai.
she's like correcting me like the whole time. Okay.
Wait. Are we out of chai?
I didn't get any. I was trying to get some, but I think we're out of chai.
Well, there might be more. Okay. We might have more.
We'll take care of that. So Zarna works really hard to get on food, so we want to make sure it's get eaten and enjoyed. So yes, please eat some food. So Miles Horton is one of my person that I adore. He created the Highland Center in Tennessee, and he's an educator, a white educator in the South. And I don't think he gets enough credit because he created a space for Rosa Parks, Martin Luther King, for the civil rights movement, for the workers' union, and I think it all starts with conversation. It all starts with recognizing our power and recognizing our capacity to do something. And so his quote is, history tells us that the minority's decisions have become the majority decisions, and that any society which doesn't allow for this to happen is going to die. And he said that a while ago, and I think it's still true. So thank you tonight for joining us.